for Dr. Chowning coming and sharing her gifts. We like to have gifted people in church, right? Gotta make up for some of the rest of us. So we're glad to have you here with us today. We'd like to again invite you to look in your worship bulletin so you can see our two scripture readings for today. The first scripture reading comes from 1 Peter and the second comes from Revelation. And I invite you to look along with me. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, see, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious. And whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a corner that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobeyed the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. And then the second reading from Revelation chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you, and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, as we again come into this time of reflection, I ask that the words that I speak might be consistent with your will for us. And if there is anyone who needs to hear a different message, that you might speak directly to their heart, mind, and soul, that they may be aware of the love, care, peace, and comfort that you offer in this morning. For it is in your Son's name that we pray. Amen. Today we are doing something a little bit different. For the first time, at least the first time since I've been here, as a congregation, we are doing a unified study that branches Sunday school classes into our worship service, into the sermons. And I think that this is something that is good for us maybe to do from time to time. So this is a little bit of an experiment for us. Today would be the most difficult day for Sunday school classes because many have not had a chance to read the first three chapters yet. But if you have, or if you've already had your discussion in Sunday school, you know that the place where we begin is a young man, Julio, who is traveling with his grandfather. They are going on a journey together, and there is a sense of excitement, and there is a sense of anticipation, both for Julio and for his grandfather, Antonio. Antonio. Now, you all may have discussed this in Sunday school class, but how many of you have a cherished memory of a trip with a grandparent? Aren't those special memories? I remember as a child when I would go and I would spend the night with my grandparents on my mother's side, and I had the chance to go out with my grandfather. He ran the gas delivery for MFA, Missouri Farmers Association, around that part of Paris, Missouri. Large city in Missouri. And I remember being so excited when I got to go with him in that big old gas truck. And he would always try to engage and make it fun for me, because sometimes when you go out with grandparents, it's awesome, right? And sometimes maybe it's a little boring. But I was always excited to go with my grandfather, and he always planned ahead. And one of the things that he did was he kept in a coffee metal container in the center of his big truck, bubblegum. And so when we would go to a farm or we'd pull up to a business, children that knew who he was would run up to the truck to get something as simple as a piece of gum. But he always had such a warm smile, and it just felt fun to me to do those things. And sometimes he would take me into a business with him when he was conducting business inside. And I remember one particular occasion. He and I walked in together, and the manager of the business said, "Who's that you have there with you this morning?" And my grandfather said, "Well, just some straggler I picked up off the street." Now, that's just a silly little bit of humor, right? That everybody laughed, and I don't know why, but it made me feel so big. It made me feel so important to be, I don't want to straggle off the side of the road. I don't want that again. But I knew it felt good just to be recognized in that setting. Another great opportunity we had when I was a young child growing up was our family went to Disney World. And I know it came up in our Sunday school class. Disney World may have came up in other Sunday school classes, an exciting trip. But I just remember being so excited to go see Mickey and Donald and Minnie and all these princesses, I guess, too, that were supposed to be pretty attractive. I mean, it was just a big, exciting thing to go and do. And the hotel that we stayed at is really what stood out the most to me. The name of the hotel is the Disney Contemporary Resort. I don't think that's what it was called when I went there. But if you don't know, that is the hotel that is like an upside-down V and has the monorail system that goes through the middle of the hotel. A train through the middle of a hotel. First grade, second grade, I was in awe. And this thing went fast. I remember being in that hotel more than I remember all the fun things that we did. But boy, did that stick with me in the time that our family spent in even just that hotel. Anticipation, excitement in the journey. We find that in the book, and we find that consistently in Scripture, do we not? Imagine Adam going around creation for the first time. The journey of finding all of these new things that God has created. We know the story of the Exodus, the journey into, the journey out of the Exodus. We know the story of the journey of Mary and Joseph and their infant. Okay, I think an easy one today, y'all. And their infant?
Jesus.
All right, we know the answer, right? That's a church answer if there ever was one, right? Jesus. We know about their traveling and their journeys. And we know, of course, even Jesus' journey with his disciples, where Jesus traveled everywhere, not in a limousine, not in a Cadillac, but on his two, and sometimes in the water on a... I like to travel with comfortable shoes. I like air conditioning. I like a cold drink once in a while. But Jesus is traveling in a different way and traveling with his disciples on this journey. And as he does so, even as he travels, travels the last journey from the triumphant entry into Jerusalem into his death, he continues to do something consistent, and we find it in the Old Testament as well. He continues to tell over and over again the narrative. He continues to tell over and over again the story. And that's a part of what we're doing as we look at the monk and the merchant, and we look at our own lives, and we look at Scripture. We are looking at the journey that we traveled together. Now, it may have surprised you early in the book setting, it's not hard to figure out, that the setting for the church as they are traveling to St. Peter's Cathedral, it is a very Catholic setting, right? But it also has to do with the time period for which it is set there in the 1600s. So it's helping to paint the picture. And can you imagine Julio, this little boy with his grandfather, going into the city and seeing things that he had not seen before, and hearing things that he had not heard before? It was a part of what his grandfather, Antonio, had chosen for him to experience. Let's look at this first passage from 1 Peter. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house. How many of you all have clean houses at home this morning? Come on, y'all. It was the weekend. Didn't y'all? Yeah, you clean on the weekend, right? No, we watch football out there with me, but how many of y'all have corners in your house that have not been touched for over 2 years? See, now it's tricky because now we got husbands and their wives and it's a quick battle there. There are things that we do that we take care of in our homes. For example, the places where people often visit. My kitchen is kept, well, of course I don't use it, but if I did, my kitchen would still be more clean than my back closet where I keep my dirty clothes, right? I just care more about how that looks because people are going to see that. They're not going to see the other. But we also have another obligation, as this scripture reminds us of, to maintain our spiritual house. And are there places in our spiritual journey where we have not been for years? Are there places in our spiritual life where we do not engage beyond what is simply presented in front of us, the kitchen of our spiritual life? Or do we push ourselves not as dead stones sitting still, but living stones where we're out working our faith, learning more about our faith, and growing in our faith? If Antonio just stays home with Julio, he can tell him all sorts of stories, right? But it's a different thing when you're traveling, isn't it? It's a different thing when you are experiencing life, where you are experiencing the journey. And are you chosen by God to be a part of this journey, do you think? Right? How many of you all have not been chosen? Because really we just want y'all to leave because you're not supposed to be here. We're all chosen, aren't we? Every single one of us are chosen. God has given you gifts and talents, not at random, but for a reason. God considers you a precious stone. You are of great value. God has equipped you for a reason. To be a living stone. To be out there living the narrative. It's not enough just to tell it. It's just not enough to say, hey, Spencer, I'm going to grab you. I'm going to put you on the second row in church. You're going to listen to Mike. You're going to pay attention. You're going to lead. You're going to do everything he says, right? Smart guy. He's thinking it over. Right? That's not enough. It has to be fuller than that. It has to be the part of the fabric of who you are, the core of your being. It can't be something that you just get, go, and be told. It has to be part of who you are. You have to be a part of that response to God choosing you. Otherwise, you're left like a dirty corner in the house, not paying attention to, not bearing fruit in God's world. But because God has chosen you, God has equipped you, you have a story to tell. That's a part of the reason why we're doing this the way we are. With Sunday school classes still in there, saying Sunday school classes where people know each other, but then also offering a new Sunday school class that I'm the facilitator for, but we have a little bit of help in the teaching for that class that's meeting in the JCAC next door, a new Sunday school class. But we're sharing stories. And one of the things about our being in a Sunday school class, you know a lot about each other already, but it gives the chance for new stories as well. It gives a chance for you to share your life and Christian narrative. God is weaving a narrative through your life for a reason. You may take that narrative one place or the other. It's not always good, is it? If you follow me around in my life and I'm telling you my life story, there's going to be a lot of hiccups. I mean, you all know about me smoking in the sixth grade. There's a lot of worse stories out there than that. Right? Even if that is where I felt my call. Doesn't God call us in some unique scenarios? In some unique situations? And yet, we're called to be people that live life to its fullest with a purpose. Did Christ come into the world with a purpose? Did you come into this world with a purpose? How are you doing with the building of your spiritual sanctuary? How are you living out of that call? One of the challenges that we see from the book is a reference to a passage in Revelation. And I'll be honest, I didn't say this in first service because I didn't want to turn anybody off, but I think it's a little misinterpreted and a little out of context. But I still think there's value in the scripture, of course. And so I want to lift up that particular verse where it says, to him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priest serving his God and Father, to him be the glory. How many of y'all ever thought about being a minister? We did a good job. Daniel, Mark, you got some other hands here and there. There's all sorts of good reasons to go into ministry, right? And there's also a lot of bad reasons to go into ministry, right? If I'm needy and I just want someone to tell me they love me, Hazel's going to tell me she loves me, right? She's going to be nice. She's going to greet me every Sunday. She's going to offer me a bulletin. And I'm going to turn her down every Sunday because I already have one. But that is a gift of ministry, isn't it? Just to be there and greet us. We talked about our roles in the church. One of the things that this book lifts up is the role of merchants and ministers. Ministry is not always easy. But I believe, and we as a denomination celebrate, that even if you are a business world, you are still a what? Priest. We believe in the priesthood of all believers. Not just the brainiacs, not just the good-looking people, not just the needy people, not just the unselfish people. We all come together. Just think about all the different characters in Scripture and their life stories, the mix of what it is. And we look at this calling that we have, and we recognize that our lives matter too, don't they? One of the things we celebrate with reconciliation is not that one particular race life matters over the other, but whose lives matter? All, do you agree? All lives matter. And as you think about that, we are challenged. What are we doing as living stones with that call that we have? The challenge to really be a part of God's call. And if so, part of it is that you and I are in this together. True? Now, I know that when the mail comes and it's church newsletter day, you all nobody runs to the mailbox anymore, do they? The only thing that's going to be in there is just PR, junk mail, whatever. You know, we don't do that as much anymore, except for on Church Newsletter Day, where you run and you open it up because you're so excited to read the first article, right? Very front page, same guy houses it every Sunday almost, every Monday almost, and that little guy writes his little words, whatever his little thoughts are, but he closes it the same way every week, right? And then that fool, which is me, says, thanks for sharing the journey. We're all in this journey together. I'm part of your journey, you're part of my journey. That's one of the things that I like about this book in the weeks ahead. It fits every generation. It fits wealthy, poor. It fits all sorts of different categories of life, and it gives us the chance to share our journeys, to share our ministry, to share our life with one another, so that we can more fully appreciate one another and grow in who we are, to more strongly be, to more cleanly be, to be more clean with our houses and our sanctuary, to get that dust cleaned out, that we truly might be a part of one another's narrative, sharing the journey even as Jesus shared it with the disciples, and that we might do so not for our own sake, but for God's glory's sake. Amen.
At this time, please stand as we sing hymn number 540, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go.